Order, and it's time now for questions to the Office of the First Minister and the Deputy First Minister, and we'll start with listed questions. And I call Mr. Sean Rogers. Mr. Rogers.
Question number one, Mr. Speaker.
Mr. Speaker, with your permission, I will ask Junior Minister McCann to answer this question.
Mr. Speaker, with your permission, I will answer questions one and three together. The written statement made by the First Minister and Deputy First Minister on the 19th of February gave the commitment to extend legislation to give legal protection from unfair age discrimination to those aged 16 years and over by those providing goods, facilities and services. It also announced the intention to bring forward a consultation document setting out proposals for legislation. Our proposed consultation is the first step towards ensuring that an anti-discrimination legislation is brought forward as soon as possible to protect people over the age of 16 from harmful and unjustifiable age discrimination. It is important to say that there are a lot of very challenging issues for people from the ages of 16 to 18, and we recognise this as a step forward. We recognise also that the decision on the scope of the proposed legislation has come as a great disappointment to some, and we will continue to work with a wide range of people within the children and young persons sector to seek to redress issues affecting children under the age of 16. In terms of the budget necessary to develop this legislation, the cost will be met using in-house resources.
Thank you. And I call Mr. Rogers for supplementary.
Could I thank the member for the answer and ask her to give an estimated timeline for the rollout of this legislation?
Well, obviously, I mean, the consultation will have to be agreed first at the executive and then a consultation paper put out. And we're hopeful, but we won't know until the consultation, the results of that consultation, and the people's views come back as to what we have to do then. So I think that really, you know, we're hopeful that we'll be within this current mandate, but obviously we'll not know until that consultation is out and people are having there, because we're very, very clear we want people to have their views and their views to be listened to as well.
Can I ask the Minister if this legislation has or will be subject to equality impact assessment?
Well, the public consultation on the draft policy proposals for the proposed legislation will be conducted in compliance with the Department's statutory equality requirements that are already there. So the equality impact assessment will be completed in line with Section 75 and Schedule 9 obligations and Equality Commission guidelines. And they will consider the impacts on each of the nine groups on the various categories within Section 75. So for each consideration will also be given to those who are going to be impacted who are not covered by the proposed legislation. Officials will be meeting key stakeholders over the next few weeks to discuss the development of this equality impact assessment.
Mr. Chris Little.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Can I ask the Junior Minister if delays to the delivery of age discrimination legislation, the racial equality strategy, gender equality strategy and the sexual orientation strategy bring into question OFM-DFM commitment to the delivery of equality for everyone in our community?
Well, there's certainly no question on the commitment from our party in terms of delivering equality legislation. The member will be aware, and the member was part of some of the meetings that we had, both inside the committee and outside the committee, that there was difficulties in getting this particular agreement, political consensus on this particular agreement in terms of the scope of the legislation, and that's what the delay was in this instance.
Comes Lord Morrow.
I'm sure the Minister would agree that discrimination can raise its head in many forms. And would she agree with me that the attempt of recently to deprive a village of its right to vote in its own village, namely McGashel, is also a fundamental right? And would she agree with me that that is something that she would like to see addressed also, and that that right be afforded to them?
Well, I would just want to say to the member, people have a right to vote as well, and you're discriminated against people when you are saying that certain people can't vote. Can I just say that I'm very, very clear in this, and we're very, very clear from this side of the chamber that, you know, no one should be discriminated against, whether it's because of their sexuality, whether it's because of their age, or any other forms of discrimination, that no one should be afraid of any legislation that brings equality for everyone.
I call Joanne Dobson.
Thank you,
Mr. Speaker, can I ask the junior minister what message do you think it sends to the under-16s by not including them in the proposed good facilities and service legislation originally with us?
As I said before, when this was introduced in the Assembly and the last time I was speaking, I would rather be here today saying that this legislation covers all ages, because I think it's very, very clear that when you're doing any sort of anti-discrimination legislation, that to discriminate against one part or one section is wrong. But I think that, again, go back to it, and all members in this House will be aware that this was an issue, that this was the only place where we could get the political consensus to take this forward. And at the minute, we don't have any equality legislation in terms of age and goods, facilities and services. So I'm hoping that this is a starting point, and I'm hoping that, that we can continue to improve that to include all ages.
And before we proceed, can I just inform members that questions 4 and 10 have been withdrawn within the appropriate protocols. And I call Ms Sandra Overend.
Please.
There is no current agreement on the regeneration of the maize along Kesh site. We continue to discuss a way forward.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and thank the Minister for that update. But given that the peace-building centre at the maize is now dead in the water, as I understand it, can I ask the Deputy First Minister what is the EU's current attitude to locating a peace-building centre at a location somewhere else other than the maize, and will the Deputy First Minister actively lobby to locate it elsewhere?
Well, first of all, I think that the member needs to recognise that the development of the maize long Kesh site was a programme for government commitment, and the first stage of that process was the relocation of the Royal Ulster Agricultural Society from the King's Hall to the site, alongside the construction of the Peace Building and Conflict Resolution Centre, for which many millions have been allocated from the European Union. For the member to describe the project as dead in the water isn't something that I recognise. I have a very clear view that whenever we make commitments, that we keep the commitments. And there is a very strong commitment in the development of the Maize Long Kesh site for the Royal Ulster Agricultural Society and the development of that to move in parallel with the construction of the Peace Building and Conflict Resolution Centre. Now, that hasn't happened, but I have kept my word to the Royal Ulster Agricultural Society, and even in the course of the last couple of weeks, the request that they made to the First Minister and myself that they relocate a pavilion from the King's Hall to the site, which would greatly enhance their sustainability on the site, I had no difficulty in giving clearance to. So I think what we have to do is continue with our discussions and see if we can't find a way forward. I'm very determined to find a way forward, and I hope that those people who opposed the project in the first instance, including the member's own party, would recognise the opportunities that the construction of a peace building and conflict resolution centre can provide for the whole purposes of reconciliation and peacemaking between all of us.
Thank you. And I call Mr. Alec Maskey.
Can I ask the Minister, as a follow-on to that, would the Minister agree that the MLK site should be open for a wider public use?
Well, I do believe that a great opportunity has been missed at Maize Long Kesh, and I believe also that we're all the poorer for that. You just have to look at the success of the relocation of the Royal Ulster Agricultural Society from King's Hall to the site, and it demonstrated absolutely that people were literally voting with their feet for the development of the site. And I'm not going to repeat myself on what I said earlier, but in the Assembly in September 2013, I made a commitment to the RUS, and I have abided by that commitment, and I wish them every success. The First Minister and I, alongside our Agriculture Minister, have been to the last two shows at the site spoken at the Dart breakfast, and it's quite clear that it has been a massive success with each year increased numbers of people from all over the island of Ireland turning out, and that's heartwarming to see. So I think that from our perspective, what we need to do is recognise the importance of the prison buildings, the Peace Building Conflict Resolution Centre, the Royal Ulster Agricultural Society, and of course all of the other very exciting developments that were mooted several years ago in relation to the overall development of the site. So we will continue to work at it in the hope that at some stage in the not too distant future people will recognise that this is an enormously valuable site that can bring huge employment opportunities to people in the not just the Lagan Valley constituency, but indeed from all over the north and indeed the island of Ireland. So let's continue to work on it, and let's hope that those people who try to make an argument that it would be a shrine to something other than reconciliation and peacemaking would see the error of their ways.
Okay, I call Mr. Jim Allister.
Given the Deputy First Minister's shameful and churlish blocking of further economic development at the Maze site, why are we continuing to pay the chairman of the Maze Development Corporation? Why are we still paying him £30,000 a year plus expenses? Is that value for money?
Well, I mean, this is a very important site. A board and a chair have been appointed. We have done that in the belief that we could develop the site in the interests of all of our people, particularly people from the local constituency and indeed wider afield. So I think it is very important that we keep in place a board and that we have a chair of that board who I think has done a good job in very difficult circumstances. And I also believe that the work of the board can also be beneficial in the context of ensuring the ongoing success, for example, of the relocation of the Royal Ulster Agricultural Society, alongside, hopefully, making an argument further afield to people who previously opposed the construction of the Peace Building Conflict Resolution Centre to recognise that the Peace Building Conflict Resolution Centre should be constructed, but should be constructed for the purposes of reconciliation between us and peacemaking.
Before I proceed, can I, on behalf of the Assembly, welcome the Speaker of the New Zealand Parliament and his colleagues who have just joined us in the public gallery.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. Could the First Minister, or would the Deputy First Minister, along with the First Minister who is with us in the chamber today, acknowledge the huge loss in financial terms to the Northern Ireland economy that as long as the Maze site is not developed, that the huge loss to us in the Northern Ireland Assembly and the economy?
Well, can I add my words of welcome to the Speaker of the New Zealand House of Representatives and his colleagues. They're very welcome, particularly in the aftermath of their successful venture into the Cricket World Cup. And of course, they're probably here on a reconnoitering in terms of the Rugby World Cup, which is upcoming not too far away. But they're very welcome. We're delighted that they're here with us. And I absolutely accept the economic importance of the development of the Maze Long Kesh site. I am a fervent supporter of the development of that site. And I think the fact that I stuck to my word in relation to the relocation of the Royal Ulster Agricultural Society from King's Hall to the site is very firm evidence of my commitment to the development of the site. Now, what we need to do is recognise that we have a difficulty, that we have a problem. I think I am a problem solver. I'm a solution seeker. What we need to do is find a solution to the difficulties that we face at the moment, which will see that site move forward, be developed, and provide the very unique economic opportunities and employment opportunities for all of our people and indeed for our economy.
Good. And I call Mr. Patsy McGlone.
Kesh, question number five.
As the competition to appoint a new victims commissioner is still live, it would not be appropriate to comment further at this time. However, we place great importance on ensuring that all victims and survivors have an appropriate representative voice through the commissioner, and we want to ensure that we have the right person for the job. The closing date for applications was Friday, the 3rd of April. Interviews for the post are scheduled in May.
I call Mr. McGlone for supplement.
Thanks very much, Minister. If there was no deficiency in the recruitment process, if two applicants were deemed appointable under the appointments criteria, what objective reasons for no appointments can be made?
Well, the process to appoint a new commissioner was taken forward by HR Connect, and advertisements were placed in local and national newspapers. The closing date for applications was the 12th of September 2014. Interviews took place in around October 2014. The Victims and Survivors Forum was consulted on the skills and qualities needed for the role and were taken into consideration when finalising the necessary skill sets for the incoming commissioner. The appointment process was regulated by the Commissioner for Public Appointments and followed the Code of Practice for Ministerial Appointments. Considering the importance that we place on ensuring all victims and survivors have an appropriate representative voice through the Commissioner, we want to ensure that we have the right person for the job. Therefore, as the current process did not produce a sizeable pool of appointable candidates, we have agreed that a further competition will be launched. And as I say, the new competition launched on the 9th of March, and the closing date for applications was the 3rd of April. So the Commission continues to operate without a Commissioner, but remains fully committed and accessible to all victims and survivors and organisations working with victims and survivors.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and could I thank the Minister for his answer, but could I ask the Minister if he can give an assurance that all future services for victims and survivors of the conflict will be victim-centred?
I think it is crucial that any services put in place to help and support victims and survivors of the conflict have the needs of victims at their centre. And in order to ensure that this happens, it's important that discussions with victims, families and other stakeholders take place on a regular basis. Following the review of the Victims and Survivors Service, there were a number of recommendations put forward, and a report on the progress of implementation of these recommendations has been positive, acknowledging improvement in many areas. The remaining outstanding recommendations relating to the assessment process, monitoring and evaluation, protocols for dealing with the psychologically injured and better management of communication with individual victims and survivors will be taken forward as part of a collaborative programme of work to examine service delivery model which currently provides services to victims and survivors. Preliminary discussions have already taken place with a number of key stakeholders to communicate the approach being taken and to seek early feedback on key issues. The collaborative design programme will continue throughout 2015-16 to progress the strands of work and seek input from the sector on the redesign of the service delivery model.
Mr. Chris Little.
Mr. Speaker, can I ask the Deputy First Minister when OFM DFM will publish research conducted by the Victims Commission with regards to the pension for seriously injured?
Well, this is part of an ongoing body of work, and we hope that that will be published as soon as possible.
Peter Weir, if he has recovered his breath.
Question number six.
Mr. Speaker, with your permission, I'll ask Junior Minister McCann to answer this question.
Mr. Speaker, with your permission, I will answer questions 6 and 8 together. On the 20th of March 2014, the First Minister and Deputy First Minister announced the first two urban village locations as Collin Town Centre and Lower Newtownards Road. Work is progressing and stakeholder engagement is ongoing regarding the development of both locations. Plans are progressing to develop a coherent town centre for the Collin area with inputs from a range of departments. Community engagement commenced in Lower Newtownards Road in October 2014. Options are being considered in conjunction with stakeholders on developing concepts to deliver a sustainable urban village. Junior Minister Bell and I announced three further urban village locations recently.
the Markets Donegal Road, or Donegal Pass, Sandy Row and the Bogside Fountain, and on the 21st of January and on Ardoyne and Ballysillan on the 16th of February. This brings the number of urban village projects to 5, one more than what was originally committed to within the strategy. The next step is to establish a project team for each new urban village to engage and work with the community to determine the boundaries of the urban villages, assess what is needed and develop the priorities for each area. The Department for Social Development has convened a programme board to coordinate and oversee the planning, design and delivery of all aspects of the urban villages, and the project boards will be set up for each of the urban villages. These will be supported by the Urban Villages Strategic Board, chaired by Junior Minister Bell and myself.
Mr. Peter Weir for supplementary.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I thank the Junior Minister for her response so far. Can I ask the Junior Minister to elaborate on the more recently announced ones in Sandy Row, Donegal Pass and the Markets as to what progress is being made there and what the timeline is for those?
Obviously, I mean, they're all at different levels, and there's at the minute what is happening is that the people are consulting with the community stakeholders to see what actually, first of all, the boundaries are going to be in those particular urban villages, but also then to go on to see what the priority are, because the difference between urban villages and other things that have happened is that it's actually going to be community led in terms of. There will be actually three different governance structures, one, as I said, at the strategic level, another one at a board level, but also one with stakeholders from the community sector as well, who will be engaging. So the two that the member mentions, obviously, are in the process of the co-design that's going to be taking place in that.
I call Mr. Gerry Kelly.
Thank you, Minister, for her answer up till now. And she went through a number of projects. Could you give me, even in terms of rule of thumb, when the actual physical work might start? I'm particularly interested in North Belfast, but indeed in any of the urban village projects.
Well, obviously, as I said in my previous answer, that you know, there will be different levels that each area will be actually at the moment. And just in terms of the costs, obviously, the indicative cost for each urban village will be different. And as we are at the stage of the co-design process, as each of the urban villages will have its own unique design, it's really impossible to give a sense of that. But once we have a sense of what is actually needed and then putting the cost to it, there has been £2.46 million that has been confirmed to be taken forward to in terms of with the Urban Village Programme out of the Together Building United Community overall budget. So I think that once we actually see the co-design and we work with people on the ground, first of all designing the boundaries, but also then to see what each urban village actually wants and what the people in that local community, because that is what it's about, it's what the people in that local community want for their urban village, then we can say, you know, put the cost, and then we can actually maybe hopefully see something happening. But we are saying that currently that process, both for resource and capital build, is ongoing.
Jim Humphrey.
Thank the Minister for her answers. Can I ask the Minister, in relation to the Ardoyne and Ballysillan urban village, which I very much welcome in my constituency, can I ask the Minister for the structure and the process that will take this particular project forward?
Well, obviously, I mean, as I said, there's three different levels of governance in terms of this is the strategic board, and then there's a board working under that, which is its departments. And the reason for the strategic board, which Junior Minister Bell and myself actually chair, is that we can ensure that departments then are there's buy-in from all departments, and departments are working, you know, together on this. But then you have the other level where you have the responsible the person for that, in particularly DSD, because DSD is the lead department taking it forward, and then you have the community and the sector at that level. So there's three different governance levels there, and they're all working in particularly in the co-design. Again, with the members, as I said in my previous answers to the other members, that basically what will happen first is the co-design process will take will take place. People will decide what they want in it, and then we have to look at the resource implications in terms of the delivery, and that includes also the Strategic Investment Board as well, and then what capital build, because each urban village, as I said, will be, you know, totally unique in its own. But the thing that will be sort of running right through all of them is it's coming from the community and what their needs are and getting the needs of the community.
And a call, Mr. Alban McGuinness.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Number seven.
A full public consultation, we received 97 written responses as well as 49 online survey responses, in addition to input from a number of public consultation and events with key stakeholders. Analysis of those responses is ongoing, and officials continue to liaise with the sector to ensure the evolving strategy is relevant to the needs and aspirations of the minority ethnic community. Whilst we are happy that the emerging consensus is in line with our vision for a revised strategy, there are challenges and requirements emerging that will require thought, planning and careful exploration. Officials are working through these issues and plan to engage further with representatives of the sector soon to tease out some of the content that has been included in responses to the consultation. It is important that we take the opportunity to do this. We must also take the time to identify how best to align the policy and implementation mechanisms of Together Building a United Community and the final racial equality strategy in line with the views expressed through the consultation. In further refining the final shape of the new strategy, we can give an assurance that it will be relevant, realistic and robust enough to deliver for minority ethnic people and society in general. The very significant contribution made by our minority ethnic residents must continue to be acknowledged and supported during this critical time as we finalise the strategy.
Mr. McGuinness, for a supplement.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and I thank the Deputy First Minister for his reply. But given the overall fairly critical responses by consultees, isn't it necessary, and I note the point that the Deputy First Minister made in relation to a thoughtful look at this, isn't it necessary to take more radical surgery in relation to what has been outlined by your department?
Well, I think the department recognises the importance of this issue and the importance at all times to continue to review the effectiveness of the strategy and how we take it forward. And if you look, for example, at the weekend's events, particularly in North Belfast, where there have been attacks on people from ethnic communities, which I unreservedly and totally deplore and condemn, then we obviously have, amongst a very tiny minority of our citizens, people who are racist, who are sectarian and who are very determined to make life very difficult for new people who arrive on our shores. So that does represent a real challenge to us in terms of the racial equality strategy, and it is important to get it right, and it's also important to take on board the views expressed by the member just now. So I think that given the situation that we are dealing with at the moment, it's very, very important that all of us work very, very closely together. And I would like to see, because I think that it's all very well, and I am very much in favour of putting this strategy together, what is absolutely vital in terms of combating racism within our society is the community coming together, but more important than anything else, politicians from every political party being very pugnacious and working with the local community to defeat the activities of those who bring shame on all of us. And I think that represents a real challenge. I think, I have to say, in the past, there appeared to be a reluctance to combat this issue in a way that it needs to be combated. And I think the way to do it is through very, very strong community action, the community and voluntary sector, the churches, local residence groups, political parties, the police service, whose chief responsibility is to apprehend these criminals. And all of us need to be seen to be working together in a collaborative way to send a very clear message to the racists within our society
that this is deplorable behaviour which should end, and end immediately?
I haven't time for another supplementary, which is why I allowed you, Minister, to run over the 2 minutes, but I'll remind you about it in any event. So that ends the period for listed questions, and we now move on to 15 minutes of topical questions. And I call Mr. Leslie Cree.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. The Deputy First Minister will be aware that there are several strategies within the department. I wonder, could he advise the House when they were first commenced and when they're likely to be completed?
Could the member repeat his question? I didn't pick up the first part of it.
Several draft strategies within the department have been for some time. Could he please advise the House when they first commenced, when work on them first commenced, and when they're likely to be completed?
Well, I think there are many strategies within the Office of the First and Deputy First Minister across a whole range of issues to do with how we ensure delivery for everybody within our society. I'm not really sure what sort of an answer the member is looking for, but I am willing to meet with the member, and if he wishes to do a meeting, we will gladly do that. But I would like further information specifically on what aspects of the 7 strategies that you have not indicated what they are, would like an explanation for.
Mr. Cree.
Mr. Speaker, and I appreciate the Deputy First Minister's comments, but really the point I'm getting to is that there's so many of these strategies that never seem to be completed, and we really do need to have some sort of a system whereby we actually deliver on these things. There are some, for example, that have actually been out to consultation more than once, so perhaps I will take that option up with the Deputy First Minister with a view to moving forward. Thank you.
It would have helped me greatly if the member had have given us an example.
I call Mr. Patsy McGlone.
Could I ask the Minister, please, what is the financial commitment of the Executive to Desert Crate Community Safety College in outside Cookstown?
Well, I think the member will know that this is a project that is very close to my heart. The reality is that this is a project that was also a programme for government commitment. And I think the circumstances around the project coming to fruition have been very disappointing indeed for all of us within the department, and within, I think, also the Department of Justice. I have to say, and it's not often I get the opportunity to put on the public record, I have been aware from the very beginning of this project of the Community Safety College being located at Desert Crete, that there was opposition going back years from within the police service to it going to County Tyrone. I heard this years ago, and I haven't changed my view. And I think that the people who have been to the forefront of opposing this project and encouraging others to oppose the project being located at the county, in County Tyrone, need to recognise that what they're actually doing is trying to undermine what is a programme for government commitment. The member will also be aware that just recently the First Minister and myself met a very representative delegation from the local council and the local business community, and both of us put on the record our commitment to the project. So I think a member in another circumstance in earlier questions used a phrase like dead in the water. I refuse to accept that the Desert Crete project is dead in the water. First Minister and I are publicly on the record as saying we want this to succeed. So there's work to be done. The Department of Justice, the Minister of Justice, has to bring forward a paper to the Executive. It will be discussed there, but my commitment to Desert Crete is absolute.
Thank you. And I call Mr. McGlone for supplementary.
I had asked what was the financial commitment of the Executive to the project. Perhaps the Minister doesn't have those details at hand.
The financial commitment would have to be in the context of the scale of the project to go forward. And the member, as much as I know, knows well that the essential services that we're going to relocate to Desert Crete, we're arguing that in the intervening period that their needs and requirements have changed. and the argument was put forward that the scale of the project wouldn't be as large as first envisaged. So I can't give the member a financial figure for the simple reason that what I want to see next is a paper coming forward to the executive, the proposition being made for the establishment of a community safety college. I will argue that it be at Desert Creek. Whatever scale that will be, then the financial commitment from the executive will be made to meet that scale. But we will face a battle on this. There are powerful forces out there within the services, particularly within the police, in my opinion, disgracefully, have been opposed to this project, relocating from Belfast to County Tyrone, and they have been at their work for the last number of years. And it gives me no pleasure in saying that, but I believe that to be a fact. So let's deal with it on the basis of a paper coming forward and the fact that this is a programme for government commitment, and it's one that I want to see brought to reality.
Councillor McGee Brady. Gora Maigat, Concordia. Minister, given the fact that it has now emerged that Francis McCabe Jr., who was injured in a bomb attack in Crossmead Lane in February while removing a poster, is set to lose the sight of one eye, will the Minister join me in condemning the activities of these criminal gangs who are attempting to intimidate and coerce those in South Armagh who are opposed to them? Gora Maigat.
Yeah, I have no hesitation whatsoever in unreservedly condemning those criminals who were involved in such a serious attack on Francis McCabe Jr. And I am saddened to hear that his injuries are such that he is likely to lose the sight in one eye. Francis is a lorry driver by trade, and this will have a huge impact on his life and his family. So I totally and utterly condemn those behind the attack. As I've said, they are criminals who have absolutely nothing to offer the community in South Armagh and North Louth. And I think it's very clear to all of us that the local community have made their response to this cowardly attack and took to the streets in huge numbers in support of the McCabe family. So these gangs have no support in the local community, but they must be stopped. And one way of dealing with their activities is for people in the local community, wherever criminality raises its head, to work very closely with both the police services north and south of the border. So I extend my support and best wishes to Francis Jr. and the McCabe family, and hope that he can recover from his very serious injuries.
Gaelic Minister McGee Brady.
I thank the Minister for his answer. Will he also join with me in calling upon the PSNA and Garda Síochána to step up their activities against these criminal gangs in order to bring them to justice, and to ensure that we do not see a repeat of the injuries received by Mr. McCabe? Gora Maigat.
Well, first of all, I want to pay tribute to both the Garda Síochána and the PSNI for the very effective way that they have worked together in the course of recent years in thwarting the activities of those who would attempt to use violence to undermine these institutions and to destroy the peace process. PSNI and the Garda Síochána have a role and a responsibility to deal with these criminal gangs. Both must demonstrate that they are supporting communities who oppose criminality. Actions and delivery are key from both police services on the issue, and I would call for greater cooperation between the PSNI and the Garda Síochána to take these criminals, whether in South Armagh or North Louth, off the streets. And we all understand and know that we have a particular difficulty in this part of the north of Ireland, and indeed on the border, in relation to a very small number of people who are part of armed groups who are looking to benefit financially from their own criminal activities. And the local community in South Armagh has been to the forefront in supporting the peace process and supporting the police services north and south. And in fact, the McCabe family were one of those families in the area that were very proactively involved in seeking support for the police service in the local community. Maybe that's one of the reasons why Francis Jr. Was attacked. So the attack on Francis McCabe Jr. is effectively an attack on all of us who support these institutions, and support the change that has happened within policing here as a result of the various agreements that have been made down the years. So I would encourage everybody within society to work very closely with the police services north and south. Do not be afraid to give information on the activities of these groups. These groups are acting against the interests of the local community and are basically criminal in everything that they do.
Thank you. And question four has been withdrawn within the agreed procedures, and I call Ms Bronwyn McGahan.
Can I ask the Minister how have the cuts to the executive's block grant impacted on the ability of departments to continue delivering services?
Well, I think every member in this House knows that the British Government is effectively crucifying this executive as a result of the swingeing cuts to our block grant. Over £1.5 billion has been stripped away by a Westminster Government led by the Tories, who have no mandate here whatsoever. And despite their decision to parachute candidates to a number of constituencies, with the exemption, of course, of Fermanagh and South Tyrone and North Belfast, I am confident that they will have little or no mandate come the 8th of May. So the cuts that they have imposed on the block grant have obviously had an impact on the ability of departments to deliver public services to the highest possible standards. However, it is my view that many of our ministers have performed heroically in the face of this onslaught by protecting frontline services and the most vulnerable members of our society, and we will continue to do that. But the new British Government need to end this ruinous policy of austerity. And it's quite interesting listening to a number of interviews that both David Cameron, Theresa May and George Osborne have been involved in over the last couple of weeks. Whenever they're challenged about whether £30 billion worth of cuts will come, including £12 billion affecting some of the most disadvantaged, vulnerable, disabled and marginalised people within our society, they refuse to give an answer. So my attitude is, if the Tories are re-elected, given the threats that they have made in relation to the continuation of austerity, we should all be afraid. We should all be very afraid.
Well, Ms. Order. Ms. McGahan for supplementary.
And I thank the Minister for his response. Can I ask the Minister to comment on the potential impact of plans by the current Westminster Government to impose further cuts if reflected?
Well, I mean, I have been on the public record as saying that the £1.5 billion worth of cuts over the course of the last number of years have been directly responsible for the huge difficulties that all of our ministers in the executive have faced in the course of recent times. And it's sometimes very dismaying whenever it is reported in the media that these cuts are the responsibility of the ministers in the executive, when in fact the cuts originate from London and directly from the austerity agenda being developed by this Tory-led administration. And whenever we hear that further cuts are coming down the track within a two-year period in the aftermath of the election, if the Tories are re-elected, I think that that spells huge issues of concern for our administration. And the Tories, in my opinion, don't get it. They don't get the fact that a society emerging from conflict, a society emerging from conflict with all of the problems that entails, requires to be dealt with in a way that ensures that people who were subject to that conflict benefit from the fruits of peace. And what we're seeing now, by the stripping away of the funding from various departments, is a full-blooded onslaught by a Tory-led administration on a people who deserve better. So these are difficult times. These are very challenging times. The British general election outcome is going to be very important, but whoever emerges leading the new government needs to recognise the special circumstances that exist here and in no other place.
Thank you, and I call Ms Megan Ferran. And I have to say, I will not have time for supplementary, so you can choose to use it if you wish now.
Can I ask the Minister for an update on the Child's Right Indicator Framework?
With your permission, Mr. Speaker, Junior Minister McCann will answer this question.
The aim of the Child's Rights Indicator Framework is to develop a set of indicators which can be used at a strategic level to measure and monitor the Executive's progress on effectiveness and achievement against the United Nations Conventions on the Rights of the Child. The UNESCO report represents a major step forward, and we are currently reviewing the child rights indicators identified in its final report. As it stands, the report and the outcome indicators it contains does not represent a full or comprehensive child's rights indicator framework. However, we acknowledge it is an important first step and advocates an approach to the development of the comprehensive framework.
Thank you. And that brings us to the end of the period for topical questions. And we now